Hi everyone. I'm going to be continuing my discussion of rhetorical appeals, and it's going to lead me into talking about illogical ways to appeal to your audience and flaws in logic, arguments that aren't sound. They don't hold water, what we call logical fallacies. So I'm going to jump right into it. Last time I ended by sharing this. Image quality isn't great, but here you have a an advertisement for Colgate. Now, how is this appealing? Is it appealing using logic and facts? Is it appealing using emotion, or is it appealing based on the credibility of the person making the argument? Who's making the argument here? It says the number one brand recommended by dentists. So maybe you could say that's using kind of like statistics. If it's number one recommended, maybe I mean, I don't know if that's actually true though, but maybe they're suggesting there's some sort of statistics behind that. But then yes, there's the credibility of the dentist. Do you think that's really a dentist though? I think that's probably a model who wore a white coat for this photo. But they're still trying to appeal to you using authority, right? An appeal to an authority. That's what you do when you are trying to maintain credibility. You appeal to your audience by suggesting there's authority experts are on your side, right? And you have expert testimony. That's what they're doing. Let's look on. Meet Otis. Otis lives in a shelter. He sleeps a lot. There isn't much else to do. When people walk by, Otis opens his eyes and wags his tail. Those puppy dog eyes. Then they leave. So he eats and waits and remembers the smell of home, scratches from his owner, a squirrel he used to chase. Then he gets tired and sleeps again. When you buy pedigree, we make a donation to help dogs like Otis find loving homes. Okay, well, how's this appealing? Well, you feel bad for that dog. It's appealing to your emotions, right? They're trying to engage your sympathy. We're talking about an emotional or pathetic appeal, so pathos. You wouldn't let your child smoke, would you? Look, it's a child. Almost always when they're using a child, it's going to be an emotional appeal or pathos. You wouldn't let your child smoke? No, I wouldn't let my child smoke. Oh God, who's someone's letting their child smoke? Actually, this isn't even about smoking. Like smoking, eating meat increases the risk of heart disease and cancer. Go vegan. I feel manipulated now. I feel like they showed a picture of a kid smoking and it got me upset. And then it's not even about smoking, it's about meat. And you know, personally, I don't have any problem with eating meat, and I don't think it's comparable to smoking as far as heart disease and cancer and health-wise. I think that kids need the protein, and so I feel like this tricked me. They have lost credibility. Do you see how you lose the credibility of the person making the argument? This PETA made this argument with this ad, or the ad agency that they hired probably. They've lost credibility in my eyes because I feel like their argument was manipulating me. That's very important. They relied too much on an emotional appeal rather than facts and statistics. Now, you might say there's got to be some facts behind that, right? Eating meat increases the risk of heart disease and cancer. Oh, okay, so yeah, maybe they did use some logos, but I feel like they were fear-mongering or you know, manipulating my emotions by showing a child smoking when that's not even what this was about. And so they lose credibility in my eyes. Also, my argument was those two things aren't similar. They're drawing a comparison between two things that aren't really similar. This is actually a logical fallacy. I don't know if I'm going to talk about it in this presentation, but because there's so many logical fallacies, but a false analogy. saying that these two things are the same when maybe they're not. Here we have Shaq suggesting that icy hot patches are good to use. Okay, so this is relying on the credibility of the person. Why is Shaq a credible expert? For, the credibility of this relies on him being an expert. Is he an expert when it comes to icy hot patch? Is this a proper appeal to his authority? Does he have authority? Well, he's probably had sports injuries before. Maybe he's used it. Okay, I can see that. Here you see, need another reason to go vegetarian besides this cute pig? Do you really want to keep eating bacon because this pig is cute? Well, again, it's children and innocent animals. Often it's an appeal to emotions. They're not using much in the way of actual logos or facts or statistics or anything here. They're just showing you an animal and then saying, need another reason, when they actually haven't given a reason. I guess what they're suggesting is that you should feel sympathy, right? So it's relying on the emotional appeal. here you go. 98% of people click, 35% of road deaths don't. So how's this appealing? Well, it's got statistics, right? So logos. But then it's showing like a bloody seatbelt. That might be appealing using fear. So that's an ethical appeal. And then, does it add up? Well, it seems kind of odd. You say 98% of people click, 35% of road deaths don't. To me, this looks like it might be misleading statistics because it's not that clear, right? 98% and 35%. It seems to be giving percentages of two different things. 98% of people click, right? It doesn't say it says 35% of road deaths don't click. Okay, so they're saying people who die on the road, the amount of people who die in car accidents, 35% of them didn't have seatbelts on. That's what that's saying. It doesn't actually seem to connect to the 98% of people who are clicking. Those two statistics seem to be about different things. The number of people who wear seatbelts and the number who don't, and the number of people who have, of the number of people who die in road deaths. It's a bit confusing when you really analyze the statistics. So to me, I feel like it could have been a bit clearer, but it's not bad. Here's this one. Why is it so hard to see black and blue? Some of you may recognize that dress, right? That's that dress that some people, a lot of people say is a white and gold, looks white and gold to me, but some people say it's a black and blue. But the point here is that maybe you're just noticing the dress and not noticing that this is a battered woman who has injuries on her wrist, knees, and face. So it's saying 1 in 6 women are victims of abuse, and that's no illusion. So it's using some statistics, 1 in 6 women. It's also showing you the image and actually playing with the idea that it's hard to notice sometimes. It's using a couple of things. I think this is a pretty effective argument that's being made. Okay, what about this one, though? We've seen before with the Shaq one that when it's using a spokesperson, a celebrity spokesperson, that it's an appeal to an authority, right? And the only way that this actually is that the people making this advertisement, this argument, maintain credibility is if this person really is an authority in selling you this product. So why would Brad Pitt be an authority on Chanel No. 5 cologne? I guess that's for men. So there's a few ways to view it. people who find this ad effective might think, you know, that, oh, well, he's successful in his, romances. Everyone wants Brad Pitt. So maybe if I buy that for myself, you know, people will want me or something like that. That kind of makes sense. if someone's partner is buying it for their, you know, their partner, maybe they want their partner to smell like Brad Pitt. I don't know. So there's a way that you can interpret it, but it's not that he's an authority on, you know, how people smell. You've all probably only seen him on the screen. So maybe he really stinks in real life. Here you see a child. It's going to be an appeal to emotion. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. Yeah, the safety of your children, right? Not so much statistics about safety, although there may be something there and it's just too blurry for us to read. The main thing is appealing to your emotions. Are you a smoker? This is the amount of tar in your lungs after 2 years. Okay, so that could be maybe statistics based on size, although I can't really tell from this advertisement how big that is. Could be like this big on the ground, or it could be like a parking space. It's hard to tell. I guess the leaves there seem, the leaves must be for scale. They need a banana for scale, but they're not giving it to us. But yeah, maybe appealing through fear, like, oh God, that makes me feel unhealthy. I need to stop smoking or whatever it is. Here, there's no better friend, adopt a dog. Definitely appealing through emotions. Look, she's crying, she's eating ice cream, and the dog is offering her a tissue. It looks like someone adopted Otis from earlier. If you recall, Otis is the dog that needs to be adopted. Straight talk. Okay, so this is the last one I'll show. Again, it's a celebrity endorsement. It is a celebrity spokesperson. As we've seen before, for this argument, for this advertisement to maintain credibility, then really it needs to be an appeal to an authority for it to make sense. Otherwise, it's just a manipulation because, oh, I like that celebrity, so I'll buy the thing, even though this celebrity is just being paid to endorse the thing. Well, with Shaq, it kind of made sense. With Brad Pitt, we could see, okay, maybe, but why should I care about the batteries that Michael Jordan likes? Is Michael Jordan an expert on batteries? No. If you read it, they try to come up with a lame excuse. It's supposed to be Michael Jordan quoted as saying, that if you're not satisfied, you can get your money back. You can't lose. I like that. I guess the idea here is, oh, Michael Jordan can't lose, right? And you can't lose because you'll get your money back if you don't like these Rayovac batteries. Well, this is an appeal to a false authority. This is one of the logical fallacies. This doesn't make sense logically as an argument. You can't appeal to someone's authority when they have no authority on a subject. It's a flaw in the argument that's being made, an appeal to a false authority. Well, there are many flawed arguments like that, and that's what I wanted to talk about in this video. Weak arguments, arguments that rely on illogical statements like that. Like, making your argument based on an appeal to someone who doesn't have anything to do with your argument. They're called fallacies. And it's a weak link in the chain of your argument, which you can see illustrated there. So I'm going to go through several logical fallacies. On this page, there is a much shorter video than this, where I find it useful as a woman who goes through even more logical fallacies than I'm going to go through, and she gives examples of them. She talks pretty fast, though. So I'm going to talk about some of the main logical fallacies and give them more more discussion. And the non sequitur, so a lot of these have kind of Latin or Greek names. I don't know what, probably Latin. A non sequitur has to do with sequence, S-E-Q-U. It's like a non sequitur means it does not follow. Like it doesn't follow, it doesn't go in that sequence. Excuse me. So the idea, it's a conclusion that doesn't follow logically based on the evidence. This is an example of trying to reach a logical conclusion from premises, but your premises, while your premises may be valid, the conclusion you reached is not valid. There's something missing. So it doesn't, these two facts don't lead us to this fact. So here, I read about a pit bull attack. This is true. My neighbor owns a pit bull. This is also true. Therefore, so this is a fact. This is a fact. This is a fact. Therefore, something else. Therefore, my life is in danger. That conclusion is not correct. You know, your neighbor's pit bull might be a sweetheart. All men die eventually. Fact. All canines are mortal. Fact. That means all dogs must die too, right? All dogs go to heaven. Therefore, all men are dogs. No. Literally dogs? No. Doesn't make sense. I mean, maybe figuratively, dogs. Maybe metaphorically, men are dogs. But just because both are creatures that die, all creatures die. I mean, that doesn't mean they're the same creature, right? So then we've got another one called begging the question. Begging the question happens when instead of making your argument, you just kind of restate what you're claiming in a different way. So basing your argument on an assumption, and that assumption has not been proven. Maybe it can be proven. And instead of trying to prove it, you just kind of repeat what you're saying. So an example. Freedom of speech is important. Okay, that's your argument. Freedom of speech is important because people should be able to speak freely. Okay, so your assumption is just, you're just restating your argument. So you say because, but that's not really a reason. You're just, again, saying it's important to speak freely. Freedom of speech is important. You're saying the same thing in a different way. That's not proof. It begs the question, well, how do you know it's better for people to speak freely? You haven't proved that. You haven't given reasons. Here, maybe here's an example of something that would be like impossible to prove. Ghosts are real because I have seen one. Well, okay. I don't know if this can be proven. Do you have evidence that you've seen one, or you are just claiming it's real again? So this is, it begs the question, how do you know that what you saw was actually a ghost? Right? How do you know that your experience is real? Do you have proof? You're not giving proof. You're just saying something is true, right? Circular reasoning is very, I put this next because it's very similar to begging the question. So circular reasoning, it's you just repeat the idea rather than giving a valid reason. Sounds very similar, right? Martha is a good supervisor because she supervises personnel effectively. Well, it's more like you're trying to give proof, but your proof is just still not, it still needs to be proven, right? It's not proof of your claim that she's a good supervisor. It's, again, restating it. A publication is pornographic only if it contains pornography. There's an old joke that you'll, if it's pornography, you'll know. But the idea here, it's similar to like if you ever tried to look up a word in the dictionary and it just gives you the definition uses another form of the same word and you're like, well, I don't know what that word means. That's why I'm looking it up, right? So you have to go and look up another word. The politician was truthful because he told us he always tells the truth. Well, I mean, he could have been lying about being truthful, right? Or here's another. I'm the best president because I'm so good at presidenting. Now, that's not a verb, but it sounds like something he would say. So I'm the best president because I'm good at being president. that's not proof that you're the best president. You're just repeating your claim, right? Okay, the straw man argument. This one's very important to understand because it's probably, it's one of the most common in poor arguments made by students. This is where you give false characteristics to the opposing viewpoint, to the argument that you are attacking. You attack that argument then based on those false characteristics. They call it a straw man because you can't engage in real argument with this. You're not engaging in a real argument with the opposing viewpoint. Instead, you make up a fake one like a scarecrow. Stuff it with straw, right? A straw man. And then you attack that scarecrow and you act like you're attacking the real thing. So it just ignores the real position that you're arguing against and it substitutes it for misrepresented, exaggerated, distorted, often oversimplified viewpoint. So this guy's saying the school budget, lunch budget must be examined. We need to eliminate waste. And then this person misrepresents what he's saying to make it easier to argue against. This guy wants to starve our children, right? It attempts to prove a point by overstating, exaggerating, or oversimplifying. This guy wants to bleed taxpayers dry. That's probably not what that person said. We see this all the time in like a gun control arguments. People exaggerate or oversimplify the other side. Gun rights activists, they will say that gun control activists want to outlaw all guns when that's not really what they're saying. Gun control arguments are usually about, if it's about outlawing weapons, it's about certain kinds of weapons, right? Like high capacity military style assault rifles, things like that. They usually aren't trying to outlaw handguns, even though the handguns are what lead to the most violence. Certainly not trying to outlaw like shotguns for home protection, hunting rifles, things like that. They may be gun rights activists are concerned about, you know, having open carry or concealed carry laws, you know, whether or not that should be something. Very specific arguments to say they just want to take our guns away is not, it's oversimplifying what they're saying. And likewise, gun control activists, they oversimplify and misrepresent what gun rights activists say, right? And they'll say, well, they're trigger happy and they just want to shoot people or, you know, they wouldn't be happy until there are no laws and it's like the Wild West. Well, it's not usually what they say. They have specific arguments too. They try to make the good guy with a gun argument that, you know, crime and mass shootings could be stopped if more law-abiding citizens carry firearms. And probably the best argument that's made by gun rights activists is constitutional, about the right to bear arms. Although that constitutional amendment is really about having a militia rather than gun ownership by the individual, but still actually addressing what the other side says would be fair and better if we were having a real academic debate. An ad hominem, this is something that students engage in sometimes as well. This is where people focus their argument on the person making the argument rather than the argument itself. They attack the person, name-calling sometimes, or picking on some specific character fault that they think is going to make them look bad, even when it might not be relevant to the argument. So Trump eats fast food and is out of shape. How can he be an effective leader, right? Famous for eating McDonald's and KFC. Does that make him a bad leader? I mean, we've had presidents of both sides who enjoy, you know, food that's not good for them. We've had, you know, lots of presidents in the past who smoked cigarettes. You know, it seems to be irrelevant. I mean, I'm not saying a president's health is irrelevant in an election because you don't want to vote for someone who might, you know, croak right when they get into office. But to suggest that it affects their leadership abilities, I'm not sure. Seems like maybe you are attacking a personal quality rather than anything else. So like this person is not an effective second in command because look at his ears. Well, what does that have to do with anything, right? This person's books about this subject are worthless now because she was caught shoplifting. Well, you know, their academic work may have nothing to do with what they've done in their personal life. Separate the work from the person, right? You've heard that before. Like, I really don't like the Church of Scientology. I think that they're a scam and they're abusive to their members. But you know what? I kind of like Tom Cruise movies. So I don't know. Maybe some of the proceeds from that movie are going to the Church of Scientology, but to suggest that the movies are bad because the main actor is a Scientologist, that may not actually hold water. You should actually criticize the movie and the content of the movie rather than attacking the person behind it. You have overgeneralization. This is where we see like a stereotype. That's where you draw a conclusion about a whole group or a topic and you don't have enough evidence. So I know several bald musicians. Therefore, bald men must be musically talented. No. I'm just because you know a couple bald musicians. How many musicians with a lot of hair are there? Yeah, I mean, you don't have enough evidence. Every time I've been to Florida, the weather's been rainy. It's always raining in Florida. Okay, so you've been there twice and it was raining those two times. That's not evidence of anything. My mother, sister, and girlfriend diet all the time. Women are always on a diet. Well, you can't make a judgment about all women based on the three women you know. This is why I tell students that they shouldn't be trying to engage in surveys that they've taken themselves. I've had students in papers try to say, oh, I took an informal survey. I took a survey of some people and like 7 out of 10 people agreed. So you surveyed only 10 people that you know. And yeah, the fact that several people you know agree with you about something is not surprising. And it's not proof of anything. A real statistician or a person taking a survey would know you need a sample size that's large enough to make the results meaningful on a larger scale, applicable to a larger population. And they need to be randomly chosen, right? So this is why I tell students, don't try to do your own surveys. If you want to study to become a survey, take a statistician or something like that, then you can design surveys and take them appropriately. But otherwise, they're not strong evidence in a paper. Post hoc reasoning, also called false cause, black cat syndrome. Post hoc, ergo propter hoc, means after this, therefore, because of this. After a black cat crossed my path, I failed my math test. That cat caused me to fail. So this is where you are attributing something to something as a cause when maybe it was just coincidence, mistaking coincidence for cause. Or maybe there's a correlation, meaning maybe there's a connection, but it's not the cause that you think it is. I was driving and I saw a black crow flying, and then I got into a car accident. I think that black crow caused me to get into a car accident. I think it was evil. I think it was a bad omen. Well, it wasn't the cause, but maybe there's a connection. The connection was you were looking at the sky instead of watching the road, you know. So make sure that if you're making an argument about effect, and all of our arguments in this class or the first two essays are about effect. They are about what causes something else. You could make the argument, for example, in our Unit 2 paper, that just because something happened at the same time, like you could make the argument that Stephen March brings up some evidence that people's confidants, the number of close friends that people had, has gone down. And at the same time, social media developed. And he suggests, the social media must be the cause of our close friendships going down. But that's post hoc reasoning. Just because something happened at the same time or one thing happened after another thing doesn't mean that the first thing caused the other thing. he's not actually proving that, right? And you could use that in your argument. You could point out that that logic is flawed. So this fallacy is also known as false cause, questionable cause, mistaking coincidence for cause. He was listening to rap music before robbing the bank. So rap music caused him to commit the crime. You've heard this before. The same thing about video games. The mass shooter played violent video games. Video games cause school shootings. Well, what about all the people who played video games and didn't do a mass shooting, right? So there's a lot of arguments to be made there. False dichotomy is saying there's only two choices, one or the other. Only two possibilities when maybe there are three or more. Only maybe, or could be there are only, you're suggesting there are only three possibilities when there are four or more. Either you support sending more troops to the Middle East or you hate our country. Well, maybe I love our country and that's why I don't want to send soldiers to a war they shouldn't be involved in, right? So there's more than one way to look at something. If you don't drive this car, you might as well not drive at all. Well, what if I could ride my bike? I mean, what if I get a used car? You know, it's not just that car. It's not my only option. He wants me to think this because he wants me to buy it. You can either stay at your current job or you're going to, you know, die starving in the gutter. Well, what if I got a better job? Or, you know, I could always get another job. Then the red herring is a distraction. It comes from the name of a stinky fish that used to distract hound dogs when they're sniffing out on a hunt. It would throw the hounds off the trail. So the red herring is changing the subject. It's like creating a distraction because you don't really want to deal with the argument at hand. So you shift the focus to something that is maybe it's connected or completely irrelevant, but you want to talk about it more than the topic that was brought up. So you're a vegetarian because you disagree with killing animals. So then how can you support abortion rights? Now, some of you might think, oh, that makes sense, but they are separate issues, right? They're two different subjects. And often to go back to that, the reason why someone might support abortion rights is not the same as their reason for disagreeing with the you know, corporate killing of animals by big meat industries. I work 60 hours a week to support my family and I pay my taxes. You shouldn't arrest me just because I drove a little drunk, Ossifer. Nice try, but, you know, I mean, it's good that you support your family. I'm glad you pay your taxes. That doesn't mean that you can break the law and drive drunk and put other people in danger. You're trying to change the subject. We can't worry about the environment. We're in the middle of a war. Well, you're changing the subject. Why did your company dump toxic chemicals in the river? This is a big thing. Corporate representatives, politicians, they like to change the subject. You'll see it in debates that they'll change the subject to something they want to talk about to their talking points. Oh, you're not looking at the big picture. What about our charity donations? What about the scholarships we provide? Well, what about them? That has nothing to do with dumping chemicals in the river. There's the appeal to the crowd. Argumentum ad populum, called the bandwagon fallacy, that suggests that just because something is popular, that it must be good or right. It's like the whole lemmings thing. If everyone jumped off a cliff, would you jump off that cliff? Millions of people believe in astrology, so there must be some truth to it. Millions of people can be wrong. This gluten-free cupcake must be better for me because everyone says gluten-free is healthier. Actually, most scholarship suggests that it's really only healthier for people with celiac disease where they specifically can't metabolize gluten. Appeal to tradition is similar. This argument says that something is good or correct because it's always been done that way. We should continue to do it the way we've always done it. We shouldn't challenge time-honored customs or traditions. Don't rock the boat. So you have to play Here Comes the Bride because that's the song that everyone plays. Well, my wife didn't play that song. Tradition's not always good. This is something to remember. There used to be a tradition that only people who owned land could vote. There used to be a tradition that people of certain races, people of certain genders could not vote, had fewer rights. You know, changing tradition often leads to progress, right? So we used to have kings. I mean, some countries still do, but many democratic revolutions changed that. And they changed a tradition that a lot of people believe wasn't a great thing. So there are a lot more logical fallacies. Like I said, there's that video on this page that's going to talk about them. I'm going to play a few videos that that illustrate some more logical fallacies. First, here's a comic strip. Just you watch, now that black can marry white, people marrying house pets is just around the corner. Roe v. Wade. So this is Loving versus Virginia. This is a decision that made interracial marriage legal. This is the decision that legalized abortion. Now that abortion is legal, we're certain to make it legal to commit infanticide. That's just murdering babies. Goodridge, 2003. If gays can marry, legal incest and bigamy will come next. And they're saying, I don't think this slope is as slippery as you think it is. So this is the slippery slope argument. I didn't mention this. Yet a slippery slope argument says that if we allow one thing to happen, if we don't fight something, then there will be all these negative consequences. But usually there's no evidence provided to really show that the negative things really will happen. It's just, you know, playing off people's fear of change. Penguins are black and white. Some old TV shows are black and white. Therefore, some penguins are old TV shows. So this is what we call a non sequitur. Remember, this is a fact. Penguins are black and white. Some old TV shows are black and white. Also a fact. Therefore, penguins are old TV. No, that doesn't work. Okay. Let me see here. Going to stop sharing for just a second so I can go back to reshare and share my computer audio for these videos.
All right, first day of school, Hunter. Remember to raise your hand in class so they see those cufflinks.
I look like our lawyer.
Exactly.
Why can't I just dress like them?
Them?
They look cool.
Excuse me, young people? Pardon me.
Mom.
No, darling, I have this.
Mom.
Where did you get these looks?
Old Navy?
The Navy. It's the Navy.
Old Navy, Mom.
Could you turn around for us? May we see the back?
Mom, please.
Hunter?
Mom.
Hunter, Mommy's speaking.
Mom,
Hunter.
It's my first
time. Hunter, season. Let Mommy handle this. And how much for the denims?
$8.
$8?
This shirt was $4.
Uh-huh. And you do know that children who lie go to prison, right, Hunter? And does there happen to be any sort of a sale?
Yeah, all kids stuff is up to 60% off.
You're going to be late today, Hunter. We're going to Old Navy.
Okay, so what logical fallacy is at work here?
Could you turn around for us? May we see the back?
Mom.
It's a bandwagon fallacy, the idea that something is good or true because it's popular, right? And so the idea that you should get these clothes because they are popular and everyone wants them. Here's another one.
You guys think being fast is better than being slow?
Yes!
It's better to be fast to not be bitten by a werewolf, and then you'll be turned into one, and you'll have to stay in, and then you'll have to get shaved because you'll be too hot, and then you're like, which means I wish I was back to a human.
What?
It's not complicated. Faster is better.
Okay, so the fallacy at work here is one that I just mentioned. That's the slippery slope fallacy. It doesn't, I mean, obviously what she's saying is silly in more than one way because of the werewolf, but she's suggesting, he asks, is it better to be fast or slow? And her argument for why it's better to be fast is because all these bad things will happen, right? It's better to be fast because if you're slow, get bit by a werewolf, and then you are uncomfortable with a lot of hair, and you know, and all these things will happen.
What are you doing? Last time I did this, I got free coffee with my breakfast.
To get your free small coffee, just order a breakfast sandwich or platter at McDonald's before June 17th.
Okay, so here we have the logical fallacy of post hoc ergo propter hoc. This is the fallacy that creates superstitions. So, you know, last time I did this, I got a free coffee. Well, he would have gotten a free coffee anyway. Just because you did this and then like hit someone doesn't mean that's what caused the free coffee. This is like, you know, I wore my team's jersey and then my team won. So therefore they won because I wore the jersey. And now I always have to wear the jersey or they'll lose, right? It's that kind of like same superstition. This is a fun one.
When your cable company keeps you on hold, you get angry. When you get angry, you go blow off steam. When you go blow off steam, accidents happen. When accidents happen, you get an eye patch. When you get an eye patch, people think you're tough. When people think you're tough, people want to see how tough. And when people want to see how tough, you wake up in a roadside ditch. Don't wake up in a roadside ditch. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV.
Okay, so DirecTV here is, again, using the logical fallacy of slippery slope. If you have cable, all of these terrible things will happen to you, right? Because of, you know, just because of cable. Now, what was the inciting incident?
When your cable company keeps you on hold, you get angry. When you get angry.
Right, so because you were on hold for so long. So their whole thing is, I guess, did they even say that DirecTV won't keep you on hold? It doesn't even really make sense unless they're arguing that DirecTV is not going to keep you on hold for a long time, because they're saying being kept on hold will make you angry, which will make you blow off steam, which will make you get an eye patch, which will make you get beat up. All these terrible things will happen, although it seems like they're just imagining it, right? That's that slippery slope. Now, here is a cable company's thing here.
Here's something DirecTV won't tell you.
So this is almost like a direct TV. It's like a cable company coming back at DirecTV, you know, and they use a logical fallacy as well.
Here's something DirecTV won't tell you. They hate puppies. Fact. They charge you every month for HD service. Fact. Time Warner Cable HD is free. Saves you what could be hundreds of dollars. Fact. You can spend those hundreds of dollars on like a mountain of dog food. Fact. Puppies love dog food. Therefore, DirecTV hates puppies. Who hates puppies?
Free HD, DirecTV doesn't have it. Time Warner Cable did.
Okay, so another fallacy. If you recall, when we're talking about the non sequitur, it's about here is a premise and here's another premise, but it leads to a conclusion that's false or not supported, at least. Maybe it's not false, but it's just not supported by your logic. So fact is your premise. Fact. DirecTV, what did they say?
There's something DirecTV won't tell you. They hate puppies. Fact. They charge you every month for HD service. Fact. Time Warner Cable HD is free.
So they're saying fact. They charge you for HD, but cable doesn't, right? Then they say that money could buy dog food. Therefore, so both of those things are true. Maybe it's true that they charge you extra for HD content. Okay. Maybe it's true that the money, I mean, it's definitely true that the money that you're being charged could be used to buy dog food, right? But that does not therefore mean that DirecTV hates dogs. So it's kind of a funny way that they're playing with these logical fallacies. But you could see that the argument wouldn't be taken seriously. It's just used as a joke. Okay, so hopefully this was helpful to kind of illustrate some of those logical fallacies. Now, the other video that I mentioned that's on this page, the woman will go through even more logical fallacies than I go through here in this video. She goes through them real fast and gives examples, but I wanted to go more in depth, and hopefully that was useful to you. All right.